God desires to bless us. He wants to pour out his spirit. I believe it's unprecedented what we're going to see and experience. But don't be moved by the shaking and the quaking, right? As the Lord's wanting us to get ready and rekindle the flame and the fire, that's what I want to talk to you about today. I want to talk to you about stirring up that gift of the Holy Spirit on the inside of you. What God spoke to you through the years, things you've heard, visions you've seen of yourself. This is the year to step into that for many of you. So I want to challenge you today and encourage you to rekindle the love. Let's do that by starting in Revelation. I'm going to start to read out of there. We're going to be in Revelation and Jude today. God takes me to this at least once a year, and I just want to make sure I keep my passion on fire. So this book of Revelation was written by John. John was the apostle who's with his name. He actually said the one that Jesus loved. He would always say, John, I, John, the one that Jesus loved. Isn't that awesome? You need to just put your name in there and say, I, say your name, the one that Jesus loves. He loves you. He loves you and he's for you. And if God be for you, who can be against you? Amen? Amen. He's for you. And so John, they think he was in his 90s when he wrote the book of Revelation. He had been exiled to the Isle of Patmos, which was basically a rock quarry where they just did slave labor and hard labor. And he was exiled there. It's interesting. He was the only disciple still alive, the one that Jesus loved. They couldn't take him out. They say it was because of his great love for the Lord. They couldn't take him out. And so here he is on the Isle of Patmos, and he has this revelation, the unveiling of Jesus Christ. And so let's go. I'm just going to jump to, let's say, verse 3. A joyous blessing rests upon the one who reads this message and upon those who hear and embrace the words of this prophecy, for the appointed time is in your hands. Isn't that awesome? I'm holding your future right here, the appointment of your future. What you see today is not what you shall be, and it is not where you shall be. We are going to a new kingdom, amen? The kingdom is in us, but he's raising up, and he's preparing a place for you even as we speak. And all these galaxies and all these stars and all these different places, we're going to inhabit all those, and we're going to do all kinds of things to the glory of God, amen? There's a future for you in the kingdom of God. Exciting things. The Bible says your eye hasn't seen, your ear hasn't heard. You can't even conceive what God has prepared for you. But he reveals it by his Spirit. He reveals what he has for you in this life. But boy, there's a whole lot more. What you see is just a tiny little inkling of what is yet to come. So don't lose heart. Don't give up. Don't you faint. Don't you fall away. The Bible does say there will be a falling away of people that will get deceived and they will turn their back on their first love. They will turn their back. You are not going to be that. Amen? Because I'm your mama and I will come and get on your case. I will chase you down because I love you and the Lord loves you and the Holy Spirit will chase you down even more than that. So anyway, let's move along here. So John was in his late 90s when he wrote this and he had this revelation of Jesus. Now to the one who constantly loves us and has loosed us from our sins by his own blood, and to the one who has made us to rule as a kingly priest to serve his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion throughout the eternity of eternities. Amen. Behold, he appears within the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all the people groups of the earth will weep with sorrow because of him. And so it is to be. Amen. I am the Aleph and the Tav, or the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, the beginning and the end, the one who is, who was, and who is to come. Hallelujah, the Almighty. And then John begins his revelation. I, John, am your brother and companion in tribulation and the kingdom. There's always both going on, right? We see it right now. Tribulation, which is persecution against the church, trouble against the church, and the kingdom. Amen? Let me just say, the persecution in the world system is no match for the kingdom. Amen? It may look like things are going wrong in different ways, but you just stand on the word of God. When Jesus was crucified, the demons in hell, you know, they were all rejoicing and they were all having themselves a party until, amen, the Holy Ghost stirred the body of Jesus Christ and God quickened his mortal body and raised him, and he's been raised and you've been raised with him. Amen. And you've been seated with him in heavenly places. The Bible says you're looking down on trouble. Trouble's not looking up at you. You're looking down, right? You're looking down and you are on the offense, no more on the defense. Amen. The church was never called to be on the defense, waiting for the devil to pick on us and then us try to defend. I played basketball, and you couldn't have a good team without a good offense and a good defense, right? Because you can defend all day long, and I was able to defend because I played with my brothers at home, and the only time I got to do anything was guard them while they got to shoot, right? So it was not good offensively, but I was good defensively. I was a hatchet man, and I would take people out. That's what the coach would send me in. The prophet would send me a little, did I know that time, but the coach would send me in, say, take out player number so-and-so, and I'd guard them 101 while the rest of the team was in a zone, and I would chase them all over the court, foul them, foul out, and get them out of the game. And so I'm here to take the devil out with you, amen? Amen? Because he's foul, and we're not going to put up with this mess anymore. So anyhow, we are here as enforcers. Jesus said, all authority has been given to me. And I give it to you, the church. I give it to you. And so this morning, we're going to talk about that authority and how we walk in that. So John was, here he is saying, I'm your brother in tribulation in the kingdom. And the patience that are found in Jesus. Wow, we need patience. And it is found in Jesus. Praise the Lord. I was exiled on the island of Patmos. And let me just say, he knew a little bit about patience. It had been over 60 years since he'd actually physically seen and heard the voice of Jesus. Now, I'm sure, obviously, he was hearing the Holy Spirit. He was hearing the voice of the Lord through the Spirit as you are. But Jesus actually appeared to him. And it had been over 60 years, so he had been patient. Amen? I was exiled on the island of Patmos because of the ministry of the Word of God and the testimony of Jesus. I was in the spirit realm on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice sounding like a trumpet, saying to me, write in a book what you see and send it to the seven churches, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamum, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. Now here he is, he hears the voice. Now he knows this voice, but it was like a loud trumpet. It was different than he heard it before. Because Jesus appeared to him as a high priest before he walked with him as his friend and he became his savior. But now he appeared to him as a high priest and a soon coming judge and king, right? And so he appeared to him and he was like, I know that voice, but something's different. And it was as a loud trumpet. And he told him to share these things with the churches. And let me tell you about the churches. Ephesus was the first church that Paul went and founded when he went on his travels and his trips. And basically what he did was he went from this church to this church. All the seven of these churches are on the same road. So they started in Ephesus. And the Ephesus church had grown and multiplied. If you read in Acts 19, incredible miracles happened at the church of Ephesus. Things that were just beyond anything. I mean, they turned the place upside down. It was incredible. And from Ephesus, it was the doorway to all of Asia. And so what happened there then spread, the word of it spread through Asia and across the whole area. Well, this is where Jesus is appearing to him and talking to him at the Isle of Patmos, but the first church he addresses is the church of Ephesus. And I want to talk about that church today. By the way, do you know that when Jesus uses the word church, do you know he's actually borrowing a Greek word? And we translate it the word church, and you and I say church, and we think of this, right? We think we're the church, the building's the church. But do you know what that real word is? It's ecclesia. And the word ecclesia was a Greek word, and it was the word for the political body that ruled all of Greece, ruled the whole empire. It was a political group that actually controlled the atmosphere, set the laws, set things in motion, decided what would be and what would not be. And Jesus chose that word to describe you, the church. The church is to set the standard. The church, the keys of the kingdom have been given to the church. We're to bind the enemy. We're to loose things. We're the ones who are supposed to control the atmosphere. When we see something going wrong, we're to take authority. We're to enforce the kingdom of God because the kingdom is in you. Amen? The kingdom is in you.
Do you want to end the war on sadness? Then click the button right there and subscribe.